Today we're going to talk about object-oriented programming. It's one of the most common ways that software is written these days, certainly for things like applications on desktops and mobile devices. The problem with object-oriented programming, though, is that it can be quite difficult to get your head around at first because it uses so many different terms. You talk about objects sending messages to other objects, objects doing things, and you think, well, they're just bits of code, how they're doing anything, and so on. And so it can be difficult to get your head around it. So Nicholas Wirth, who invented Pascal, once described programs as being algorithms plus data structures. Now, the data structures we can think of as the sort of the data that our program's manipulating, whatever that might be, and the algorithms, that's basically the code that we're running to manipulate that data. One way we can think about this is thinking about something like a simple Pong game, so one of the very early computer games you got back in the 70s. Pong was a very simple game that you played on your TV. It had, so if that's your TV screen, you had a little bat on this side, which one person controlled, you had another bat on this side that another person controlled, and then you had a ball, which was a square block. And these literally were square blocks that were filled in on the screen. So one player could control this and move it up and down, another player can control this and move it up and down, and the ball would bounce between, effectively trying to be a sort of tennis game. The graphics were state of the art for the time. I mean, you can still find Pongs lying around, mainly in museums. There's one at the Computer History Museum down in Cambridge if you want to go and play with it. So the Pong game's very, very simple, but we can use it to sort of think about how the program would work and so on and things. So you've got two bats and a ball, and so the data for this would be relatively simple. This paddle or bat over here, you'd need to know where it is, so you need its position, and we'll call that its Y position. And you'd probably keep track of its X position as well, just to make it easier to draw things. And you'd need the same for this one over here. And again, for the ball, you need the ball's X pos and the ball's Y position. So that's the data that our program would represent. It doesn't need anything more than that, really. You'd perhaps have some representation of the screen, but that'd be handled by the computer, so we'll ignore that for now. And we'd be able to write programs which would use this data, manipulate it to run the game. So if a key was pressed, we would change the Y position to make the bat go up. Or if a different key was pressed, we'd change this one's Y position to make the bat go down. And we could change this to make the ball sort of bounce off the edge of the screen, so it looks like the ball's moving around. So we're going to write some code very simply to do this. So we could say something like, if key, let's say we're going to use Q to go up, is pressed, then paddle 1 Y pos equals paddle 1 Y pos plus 1. And we could do something similar for the going down and for the same paddle. So we could write bits of program code that manipulate the variables to move the paddles around. And then we can redraw the screen. And so we redraw the screen. It looks like the things are moving. Actually, all we've done is change the variables data and then redraw the screen. This is okay, and for a simple program like this, this approach would work, and anything else would perhaps be over the top. But often you would find that you'd have lots of data that you'd want to group together. So for example, with our Pong game, we've got a variable to hold the X position, a variable to hold the Y position, a variable to hold the ball's X position, a variable to hold the ball's Y position, and so on. And we might actually say we're talking a lot of the time about points on things, so we actually want to group them together. So we can use, in various programming languages, they have the facility to group things together as what we call a data structure. And we can then refer to this position either as a whole, so we can set the position to be the same as another position, or we can refer to the individual things inside it. So we can pass it into a function, say to draw the paddle, just passing the whole position in there. But if we want to update one of the values, we can just update that specific value, like the Y position that we want to manipulate. But there's still a slight issue with this sort of approach. It makes it easier to refer to things, and we can have lots of these data structures referring to different things. Rather than having separate variables here, we could have a position for paddle 1 and a position for paddle 2. So we can refer to them and have lots of them. So we can have one data structure which we can then have many different things for. So we can actually group the data together, which is quite useful. But the problem with all of this is that the data is completely open, and we can write code anywhere in our program that can manipulate it. For a simple program like Pong, having the data open is not a problem. Your program is probably not going to be more than a few hundred lines long. But as the program grows, you're writing something bigger, then you'll have lots of files accessing the data, and you might change some things and forget to update part of the program. So for example, you might update one part of the program to only allow 10 entries rather than 100 in something, but the other part of the program still expects 100. And so it writes over the end, walks all over memory that's used for something else. So you get a crash. Your program won't work. So with object-oriented programming, we turn things on their head slightly. Rather than thinking of the program in terms of the code we write and how it modifies the data, we think rather in terms of objects. So what would an object be? Well, using our Pong example, the objects in this game would be, well, we've got two paddles in here, so we'd have objects that would represent the paddles, and we've got another object here, which is the ball. So we can sort of see what might be an object in our program. But the other thing we need to think about, rather than thinking about writing code that manipulates the data, we need to think about what these objects can do. What operations can we perform on them? So for example, on our paddle, we might have operations which make it move up. We might have an operation that make it move down. And that would be the same for both paddles. And we could ask the object to perform that operation based on input from the keyboard. So the ball object would be similar. Rather than having operations to move it up or to move it down, we just have an operation that says update your position. We let the ball itself work out how it's going to move around the screen. The other thing we might have is an operation to detect whether the ball has collided with a paddle. And in this case, we'd say to the ball, have you collided with this other object? So we'd have the two objects working together to work out whether they've collided. Now, I've described that and I've talked about objects working with each other, objects having operations. How does this all fit down to the way it works with the computer? Well, to do that, we need to think about what an object is. And actually, an object is made up of three things. So let's look at the paddle as an example to start with, and we'll think about the ball in a minute. It's got some state, and that's things like its X position and its Y position. But you might also, if you're taking this further, you might have something like the speed associated with it as well. And they'd just be numerical values, perhaps integers, floating point numbers, depending on the system that you're using. They could also be other objects. So we could build an object out of other objects, but that's going to be in advance. We'll look at that later on. So what we've got here is no different from the data structures we talked about earlier. We've got some data and we've encapsulated it together and we can refer to it as a whole. The other thing that makes it different is that we also have the operations. And these are the things that the object can do. So if we think about our paddle, we said it would be able to move up and we said it would be able to move down. We also said that you might want to be able to draw it on the screen, so we'd have a draw operation as well. We might have other operations that we need to make the program work, but these aren't things that we're necessarily going to want to do to the object, like making it move up or down. So we might have to have operations that allow us to get its position. So we might have a get position operation, and that might be used, say, by the ball object, so it can detect whether it's collided with it or not. And it's having these operations which makes a difference between a simple data structure and an object. We think about the state as being the center of the object. So we've got that state, that's our X position and our Y position. We'll keep it simple for now for the paddle. When we think about things in an object-oriented way, we say, no, there's a defined interface that can manipulate this data. And so you have this sort of ring fence around the data. So you've got the sort of move up operation, the move down, the draw operation, and the get position operation. And the only way this data here can be accessed or manipulated is by calling these operations. And these create what we call the interface to the object. You can get its position, which will give you an XY coordinate. We haven't worked out how we return that. You can draw it, and you perhaps have to give it the screen you want it to be drawn on. You can get it to move down, and you can get it to move up. And so we now write our programs, not in terms of manipulating the data, but in terms of telling this object to move up or to move down. What actually happens is that when the move up operation is performed, there's a bit of code that we specify here, which updates the Y variable, and then it returns back to whatever called it to continue working. So it's actually a way of thinking about and the way of structuring the program.
Would it be fair to say that's a small program in its own right?
Yes, I mean, that's one way you could think about it. The object is a small self-contained program that's in its own right, so it's got a move up and a move down, it can be drawn and you can get its position. And then you'd write another self-contained program for the ball, and that would perhaps have a similar state, but it would have different operations associated with it. So an object is actually made up of three things. We've seen the state, we've seen the operations, but the third thing we have is actually not part of the object as such, but we also have identity. And this is simply saying that we can have many objects of the same type. So we can have one paddle like this, But we can also, and I'll draw a smaller one for speed, we can also have another one with its state and the operations around it. And this can represent the other paddle. So we've got two objects with the identical interfaces, one to represent the paddle on the left, one to represent the paddle on the right. So the only thing that can alter the data is the operation on the object of a particular identity. So if we wanted to access it, we say to an object with this identity, perform this operation, and that would then go and modify the state of that object. And as I'm sure you've guessed, we'd have another type of object to represent the ball, which would also have an X and a Y position. And it would have a different set of operations around it. So some of them might be similar, things like we might have a draw operation, but we might have a collide operation instead. And then this time, update position. So perhaps we'd have got an increased speed operation as well. So we'd have a speed value in there. The two objects that represent the paddle of the same type, they have the same state associated with them, they have the same operations associated with them, but this one is of a different type. It's got different state, it's got an X, Y position and speed, and it also has a different set of operations associated with it. And of course it has its own identity, and if we wanted to, we could have two balls in the game. Generally, in most object-oriented languages, when we write these things, we define what we call a class, which is basically the blueprint for building objects. So it specifies what operations they have and provides the code for those operations, even though it acts on each individual object. And it also specifies how the data is stored and so on. And then when we create an object, we create a new one with its own identity, with its own state, and then the operations can perform on that individual object.
If we come to update our program, we talked about how that can be a problem with structures. How's it easier here then?
Because we've got this defined interface for the object, the rest of the program doesn't need to know anything about how that object is implemented. So it doesn't need to know there's a Y coordinate or an X coordinate in there. All it needs to know is to make it move up, it invokes the move up operation on the object, or it invokes the move down to make it move down. The beauty of this is you can have lots of different classes of objects that implement this interface. And then you can drop in whichever one you want. So you could have a paddle, which is wide, which would just be a different class of object, and drop that in. You could have perhaps a specialist paddle, which was two paddles that moved up and down in sync with each other, and that would just be a different class of object, which you'd drop in inside. And this is part of what we call inheritance in object-oriented programming, which is one of the things which can make it really powerful, which we'll look at in another video.
Over a long enough timescale, I think that human-level artificial intelligence is completely inevitable. If humanity hangs around for long enough and continues to progress in what it can do,